next time you're riding down the road in your car, sing this to the Lord. You'll get where you're going much faster. Come. Let us.
Come, let us adore Him.
Kneel down before Him.
Kneel down before Him.
Worship and adore Him.
Worship and adore Him.
Come on, say it again. Come.
Come.
Let us.
Come, let us adore Him.
Kneel down before Him.
Kneel down before Him.
In your presence, Lord, worship.
Worship and adore Him.
Help me say.
Good morning. I am Pastor Deborah Bell, and I serve as the senior pastor at the Russell Hoover Memorial United Methodist Church in Little Rock, Arkansas. We are so excited. We're excited that you have decided to join us once again. If this is your first time, we give you a hand praise. We love the fact of having new people, new viewers to come on. If it's your first time, please just say hello. Thank you for having us. And if you've been with us since March, we are again grateful. We're praying that you are sharing the information, that you're participating in our worship experience that we have here. We're excited about the presence of the Lord coming before us. Come, let us adore us. Let us adore Him as we celebrate in a worship experience here at the Russell Hoover. I want to thank all those persons who last Sunday viewed us on our 40th anniversary. It was fabulous. The Spirit of God moved, and we are ready to go to another level again on this Sunday. Thank you for joining us, and have a great service. God bless. Amen. So now this is an opportunity where you can also participate in our worship experience through the worship through giving. Did you know that we are called to tithe a tenth of every income that we receive to give it back to the Lord? We are called to give our hearts and our spirits and our souls and our services, but we're also called to give our gifts. We've been blessed that you have been providing us with your tithes and your offering, and now is an opportunity where we do this again through our worship through giving. You will see information where you can give via Givelify, as well as another way you can do it is by mailing us. You'll see the information that is below, and we thank you for giving, because the Lord says, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So, now is the opportunity where you can give. Remember, God loves a cheerful giver. Amen, and God bless, and thank you for your gifts.
Good morning. My name is Tim McIntosh. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, first of all, I want to thank you for being you, Heavenly Father. I want to acknowledge the fact that you are the beginning and the end, and without you, we are nothing, Heavenly Father. I want to thank you, Heavenly Father, for your blessings, Heavenly Father, the blessings that sometimes we take for granted, Heavenly Father. I want to thank you for providing shelter for us, Heavenly Father, for providing food for us, Heavenly Father, for providing a sound mind, Heavenly Father, for us in times of uncertainty, Heavenly Father. I want to thank you for being that light, Heavenly Father, that we can lean on, that we can see and be guided by, Heavenly Father, guided in the right direction, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, I ask that you continue your blessings on us, Heavenly Father. You continue your mercy and your long suffering and your faithfulness to us, Heavenly Father. I want to pray, Heavenly Father, that you would continue to give us the strength, Heavenly Father, that we need, Heavenly Father, to endure whatever it is that we have to endure, Heavenly Father. I want to thank you, Heavenly Father, for your Son, Jesus Christ, Heavenly Father. I want to thank you for allowing him to fulfill the prophecy, Heavenly Father, so we could have an opportunity, Heavenly Father, to be saved, Heavenly Father. I want to send a special prayer out to the Bruce and the Robinson family, Heavenly Father. I want to pray that you would release your Holy Spirit on them, Heavenly Father, and have the Holy Spirit be a companion to them, Heavenly Father, in this time of transition, Heavenly Father. You've already promised us, Heavenly Father, that you have conquered death, Heavenly Father, and this is just a transition period, Heavenly Father, and I ask that you would send your Spirit out to them and comfort them in this temporal time of loss, Heavenly Father. And Heavenly Father, I pray for the sick, I pray for the poor, I pray for the desolate, Heavenly Father, I pray for the confused, Heavenly Father. I pray that you would continue, Heavenly Father, to somehow be in their life, be a light in their life, Heavenly Father. So whatever they're going through, Heavenly Father, they can look up and depend on you, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, I want to send a prayer out to Hoover United Methodist Church and the leadership of this church, Heavenly Father. I pray that you continue, Heavenly Father, to guide them and direct them, Heavenly Father, and to allow them the understanding, Heavenly Father, to not do their will, Heavenly Father, but to do your will, Heavenly Father. And in closing, Heavenly Father, I just want to, again, thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for that gift. Thank you for that precious, precious gift that you sent to us, Heavenly Father. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that in these uncertain times, in these pandemic times, Heavenly Father, that we will continue to lean on you and him, Heavenly Father. And this is my prayer that I pray in his name. Amen.
Hi, my name is Taylor Swinton, and I will be reading Romans 16, verses 25 through 27. Now all glory to God, who is able to make us strong. Just as my good news says, this message about Jesus Christ has revealed his plan for you, Gentiles, a plan kept secret from the beginning of time. But now, as the prophets foretold and as the eternal God has commanded, this message is made known to all Gentiles everywhere, so that they too might believe and obey him. All glory to the only wise God, through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Hello, my name is Nicki Spencer, and I am a member at the Russell Hoover Memorial United Methodist Church. I'm here today to share with you virtually a Christmas story. It's the week of Christmas here for me in Little Rock, Arkansas, and I have been excitedly getting ready. For me, that means praying, it means spending time with Jesus, but it also means doing some things like shopping and cleaning up. Christmas means a lot of things to a lot of people, and this year it's going to look a lot different than normal. And that's why we're going to share some time together virtually. When a lot of people think about Christmas, especially children, one thing comes to mind for a lot of people, and that's Santa Claus. A lot of times people are preparing for Christmas in a commercial way. We're shopping, we're wondering what we're going to get or if we're going to be able to provide for children, etc. And all of those things are fine. Santa Claus is fine. Preparing for family and, you know, those things are all fine. But the true meaning of Christmas is Jesus and Jesus' birth. And so we're going to celebrate Jesus' birthday when we celebrate Christmas. And so that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to read two stories out of this book here. It's called Children of God Storybook Bible, and it was composed by Archbishop Desmond Tutu. I really love this book. It has lots of beautiful pictures, very simple stories, and I think that it's a great book for children. People of all ages, but in particular children 5 to 7, I think would really enjoy it. And so I'm going to read the two stories in the book about the Christmas experience, and I hope you enjoy it. And the first story that we're going to read is called God Makes a Promise to Mary, and it's about the angel appearing to Mary, and you can find it in an adult Bible or a regular Bible in Luke chapter 1. Mary was a young girl living in the village of Nazareth. She was engaged to marry a man named Joseph. One day, the angel Gabriel came to her saying, "Peace be with you, Mary. God has chosen for you something wonderful." Mary couldn't believe her ears. "Me? God chose me?" Mary trembled with fear. What would God want with her? What could the angel mean? There must be some mistake, she said. Don't be frightened, Gabriel said. You are going to have a baby boy, and you'll name him Jesus. You must be joking, Mary cried. I'm not even married yet. And Gabriel smiled. Don't worry, Mary. God will send his Holy Spirit to be with you. Your child will be called the Son of God. Everyone will look on him with wonder. He will be king all over the world forever and ever. Mary was amazed. She was going to bring God's son into the world. Then the angel left, and Mary was filled with joy in her heart, saying, God is good. He remembers the poor and the hungry. He has not forgotten Abraham and Sarah and their descendants. And now I will share in his plan. I will be the mother of Jesus. Dear God, please help me to share in your plan for the world. One of the things I like about this book is that the pictures are really colorful and vibrant. And so if you have a chance to get it, I think it would be a great asset. The next story we're going to read is Jesus is born. God keeps his promise. And we can find this in the Bible in Luke chapter 2. The Roman emperor ordered everyone in Judea to go to the town where their father had been born so that they could be counted. Mary, by then, was quite pregnant, and she traveled to Bethlehem with her then-husband, Joseph. When they arrived, all the inns were full. Finally, a kind man let them sleep in his stable with the animals. A cow was mooing, and sheep were baaing. Then everyone heard the sound of a baby. Jesus was born. Mary placed him gently in the manger on a bed of hay, and all the animals gathered around and tried to snuffle the new baby with their noses. Outside the town, shepherds tended their sheep in the fields. Suddenly, the sky lit up and an angel appeared. Don't be afraid, said the angel. I bring the most wonderful news. God's son has been born in Bethlehem. He will bring great peace and joy to the world, and you will find him sleeping in a manger. Soon, other angels appeared in the night sky, singing, Glory to God in the highest. The shepherds found Mary, Joseph, and the baby in the stable. They sang songs of praise that filled the night and gave thanks to God for the Savior of the world. Dear God, thank you for your son, Jesus. I hope you enjoyed those stories. I've read them several times in this Bible and in other Bibles. And one of the things that I think most about is that Mary, she was really young. And she was going to be a mother. She was going to be a mother, not just any mother. Raising children is hard. They think they know everything. My daughter tells me all the time that I know everything, Mama. She does not, but Mary was going to be the mother to Jesus, and Jesus was Jesus. He was going to know everything. And so I often wonder how hard that must have been for her, but also how glorious it was, the anticipation of knowing that she was going to be Jesus' mom. So as I leave you today, I want you to enjoy the anticipation of Christmas and whatever that means for you. Christmas is different this year. We know that. But whatever Christmas is for you and your family, enjoy that anticipation. Enjoy that wonder. And may you celebrate Jesus too on Christmas.
Good morning. I am Pastor Deborah Bell. I serve proudly at the Russell Hoover Memorial United Methodist Church in Little Rock, Arkansas, and we are delighted that you are here this morning with us as we prepare ourselves to hear the word from God. Let us go to prayer. God, right now, we want to just thank you for this opportunity, Father, to come into your house, to come into this world, to share the message that will come before us. God, we pray that as we gather here, God, that we will center ourselves and that we will not just listen, but that we will participate in the worship. God, I pray that you'll use me as a vessel to share this word this morning to your people. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen, amen. Again, we're excited about you joining with us this morning. I will be sharing with you from the scriptures, Luke chapter 1, verse 26 through 38. And that's Luke chapter 1, verse 26 through 38. So go get your Bibles or your apps and be prepared to hear the word of God. And the word reads, in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end." Verse 34, Mary asked the angel, "But how can this happen? I am a virgin." The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her sixth month. For the word of God will never fail." That's verse 37. It says, "For the word of God will never fail." Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." And then the angel left her. Those are the words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. This morning, my sermon topic, as I struggle with that, real simple though, it says, nothing is impossible with God. Again, that's nothing. Nothing is impossible with God. Let me ask you, have you ever struggled with the impossible? Have you ever looked in situations in your life or things that were happening and you might have said, that's impossible. No way, that won't even happen. Let me tell you this, Luke chapter 1, verse 26 through 38 is a story about the impossible. It is a story about the no way and it won't happen. It is the story of the angel's pronouncement to Mary when he said to her, "It is possible." There are several basic things in this story that is possible for God. The first thing was a pregnant virgin having a child and remaining a virgin. Impossible? No way, that couldn't happen. And then the second thing is Joseph following through on the marriage when he discovers that Mary is pregnant. Impossible? No way. Won't happen, but it did. In Mary's story, in verses 26 and 27, in the New Testament, there are two versions of the Christmas story. Did you know that? There are two versions. There's the Matthew, which tells Joseph's story, and then there's Luke, which tells Mary's story. So I want you to go back and make sure you read those two versions. You see, Matthew tells the story like a man would tell it, okay? And Luke emphasizes the things that a woman would consider important. You know, there's a song that sung during Christmas time that I love. It's one of my favorites. And the song is Mary, Did You Know? Talking about the impossible made possible. A couple of verses, it says, Mary, did you know that your baby would one day walk on water? Possible? No way. And then it goes on and says, Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Can you imagine Mary even thinking that that was possible? So as I continue, I want to ask you this question. What is it that you know about Mary from Luke's gospel? What is it that you know? Let me tell you a couple things. Mary's father's name was Eli. Mary had a relative named Elizabeth. Mary was a young teenager, and Mary was a virgin. Mary was poor, but she was a devout believer in God, and she was very much loved. You see, Mary, the teenager who was in love, she may have been, they say, young. She might have been 12 to 13 years old. And we're told in verse 37 that this young woman was a virgin and she was engaged to be married to Joseph. So during this time to be engaged, it was a binding agreement just to be engaged. The husband-to-be, which would have been Joseph at that time, would pay the father of the bride a certain amount of money because the father of the bride was losing a worker and the other family was gaining one. Just a little history for you. There was a period during this time in the Jewish custom for at least 6 months to a year before they would even have a wedding feast, And during that time, the couple who were engaged would be considered married and would be called husband and wife. But there were two things that they could not do, that they didn't do. Number one, they didn't live together until after the 6 months or the year when they had the wedding feast. And number two, they never consummated their marriage physically. The Jewish custom was that Mary would live with her parents and Joseph would live with his parents. Just a little history so you'll know where we are. After the wedding feast, Mary and Joseph would live together as husband and wife. So for Mary to say that she was pregnant would cause major confusion, major doubt in her character. Everyone would be wondering what was going on. But regardless, because of Mary's faith, it didn't matter to her. She realized that people would talk about her and talk behind her back, but she did not fear that. She was willing to obey God. She feared God more than she feared man. Just imagine yourself during that time in that situation. Would you have the faith to trust God, or would you be concerned about what people were saying? Would you be willing to sacrifice your reputation in order to do God's will? Just think about that. How would you have dealt with that during that time, where you could have been for the rest of your life, somebody was looking down at you and they didn't believe in you? And Jesus was going to be considered an illegitimate child, and Mary was going to be, how would you feel being called an adulterer? Well, you know, Mary lived in a small town. As a matter of fact, the town was so small that it didn't even have a name. And from the human perspective, Mary was considered a poor, unimportant teenager. But God, however, blessed her. God can use whomever he wishes. Amen, hallelujah. Even though Mary and Joseph's circumstances were not ideal, God still chose them because of his faithfulness. So today, are you willing to be faithful to God so that he can use you to carry out the promise that he gave you? Nothing is impossible for God. Nothing is impossible for God. As a matter of fact, I can share many things that I thought was impossible, and God made it possible in my life. 40 years ago, this church wasn't here. People thought it was impossible. But because of the faithfulness of you, the members, and people who served us in the community, God made it possible to be here even today, 40 years later. We just had our anniversary. God can do all things if we only trust and believe him and remain faithful. You see, Mary was a favored woman. The angel Gabriel said, "Greetings, favored woman." Isn't that a good sound? I would love to hear an angel come to me and say, "Favored woman." That's a beautiful sound. That means that God has shown saw favor in me for what it is that he might have chosen for me to do. God chose Mary, this wonderful woman, to be the bearer, to bring in his precious son into this world just for us. Mary was highly favored, but yet she was very poor in that time. So you see, it doesn't matter what your status is and where you live and how what town you live in. It just matters that you're willing to be faithful to God. God can make all things possible. And Mary, it shows that in our scripture that Mary was favored by God. God chose her for this crucial plan that he had. Jesus coming to save the world. Perhaps you view your status as a Mary. Maybe you think that you have some of the similar characteristics and lifestyles that Mary had during that time. Maybe you feel that God can't use you. God can use anybody who's willing to trust and walk and be faithful in him as he plans for us today. God used just regular people like you and me to do some extraordinary work. God is a God of miracles that can do all things if we trust and believe and follow his plan. You see, when the angel appeared, Mary was frightened. Can you imagine an angel appearing to you and showing up and saying to you, "Greetings, Deborah Bell, you're favored," or "Greetings, whoever you are, you're favored by God." So she was confused. She didn't understand this. It was sudden that that happened, but Gabriel used that famous one-liner that he uses often. He says, "Don't be afraid." Now, she was still wondering, why me? Why am I the one that God... And as she was questioning that, it wasn't because she didn't believe it. It was because she wanted to understand. She wanted to understand what her role was that God had planned for her. God had simply stepped into her life, and he brought her into service for him. Impossible, but possible with God. Did you ever feel like your life is too small for God to notice? Did you ever feel so insignificant because of something that you might have done that you feel, God can't use me? Perhaps that's how Mary feels. God is about making the impossible possible. When the impossible happens, take that blessing as a reminder of how much God loves you. Let it be proof that God is with you. He is always with us. Yet we need to believe it. God is the God of the impossible. It's true today. The same applies today. There's a situation that somebody is in that you feel that God can't use you, or that God can't turn that thing around, or that it's impossible. I can't believe it. It won't happen. Trust in God. God will use the impossible to change your life today, but you must be open to it. You must be open to it. Favor is meant for most of us. He has promised a will and a plan for each of us. We just have to be willing to be faithful and allow God to do what God does. You see, Luke paints a very significant picture of Mary. Luke says that Mary was a model believer. It said that Mary was favored by God. It said that Mary was thoughtful and Mary was obedient. She was worshipful. She was a faithful follower of God's laws. But the angel Gabriel shared with Mary as they were talking, just as he did with Zechariah's wife, Elizabeth, he'll do the same for you. Mary, he said, you will give birth to the promised Savior. Gabriel promises that she will conceive and give a birth to a son. And then it goes on and said, you should name him Jesus. He even told her what to name the child. And this child will be very great, the scripture says in verse 32, and will be called the Son of the Most High. He will reign over every
Israel. He will reign over Israel forever and ever. His kingdom will never end. His kingdom will never end. But then Mary asked, and it's okay to ask God why or how. Mary asked, but how can this happen? I am a virgin, she says. How? And the angel says, by God's power. I love that. So today, if you're asking how can something happen, it happens by God's power. Not by her power, not by Joseph's power, not by the power of her friends or family. It happens because of God's power. It's not the power of nature or the luck, but by God's power, he can make it happen. In other words, it didn't make sense to Mary that the impossible could be made possible. One thing we must also see together in this is that she responded in faith, even when she didn't understand. Even when we don't understand, are we willing to follow God? Even when we don't know what the plan is, are we willing to follow God? Are there times in your life when you just fully don't understand what God is doing? Been there, done that. Have you ever been in situations where you didn't understand why God was doing something for you? We should respond by saying, I don't completely understand this, but I do know that God is always good, and I trust God to carry me through. And so then Gabriel says, when God says the Holy Spirit will come upon you, he doesn't mean that God impregnated Mary. Come upon brings to mind Genesis 1 through 2, where the Holy Spirit was hovering over it. The face of the deep in the creation. It's what Jesus is quoted as he says in Hebrews 10 and 5. As he was coming into the world, he said, you did not desire sacrifice and offering, but you prepared a body for me. By the power of the Holy Spirit and the power of the Father, a body was prepared for God the Son, who would be brought forth by Mary. The angels assured Mary and assures us, nothing will be impossible with God. You see, the moment you admit the existence of God, you must deny the impossible. With God, it was nothing that a barren woman, Elizabeth, and a virgin woman, Mary, would both conceive. In fact, that's just what God does. He comes to us, and he wants us to trust him, and he'll make it happen for us. So for all these two women had to go through, they trusted and believed that God will never fail. Do you believe today that God will never fail, no matter what the circumstance that you might be in? Are you trusting God and allowing him to lead you through whatever plan that he has for you? So Mary had faith, even though she didn't think things were possible. She was willing to trust God. She was willing to follow God's plan, not her own plan. Today, are you willing to follow God's plan? Are you willing to allow God to use you? Are you going to remain faithful and obedient to him in these times when we have challenges and we are unsure about what we're supposed to be doing? This past week, I had an opportunity and was called by God to officiate one of my sister's funeral service. I was the one to officiate her service. Was I trusting God? I was praying to God. I was asking God, am I the one to do this? Do I need to be the one to do this? Am I strong enough, God, to do this for you, for my sister, for my family? Show me. Lead me and guide me that I can stand before the people and officiate over my sister, Jackie Bruce, my beloved sister who rests now with God. Through much prayer from many people, God made the impossible that I thought possible. It was his plan, not mine. And I'm proud and grateful that I had the opportunity to trust God and not to run away. See, today we have to be willing to step out in places that we aren't sure about. God has a plan, he has a promise, and he has a will for each of us. Just like Mary, we have to believe in God's plan. It's not our plan, it's his plan. We have to be willing to follow God's plan. Are you willing today to follow God's plan, not your own? Are you willing to do that today? Do you realize today that God can make all things possible? God never fails. And we have to trust and believe in him so that we too can be able to build God's kingdom. You see, there are many of us who face shame and frustration and anxiety. But are you willing, even in spite of those people who might be talking, or your fears, whatever it is that you feel that you can't do, God will see you through. He will see you through. So this morning, I want to ask, is there anyone today who's out there viewing, who feels that God needs to come into your life and you need somebody to walk with you through that? Whatever it is that you're facing, are you willing to say, I am the Lord's servant. I want to serve God. Whatever your will is for me, God, let it be. Like Mary, we can truly be servants of Christ if we're willing to follow his plan. He won't lead us astray. He will not lead you astray. So this morning, don't wait too late. God has a plan for your life. God has a plan for your life. God has a plan for your life. And are you willing to follow his plan? God bless you and thank you.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to us?